you know, it's biased by who is doing it. Is it the MFM or GYN? What are the surgical techniques? You know, some people, they have certain, you know, surgical technique that can minimize the amount of the blood loss. You know, how long they're going to do that? You know, we've shown that, you know, over time with the multidisciplinary, you know, you get better outcome in terms of less bleeding and less blood transfusion. So that's going to be a big, you know, these are the things that are going to be a really big confounder for see if TXA is really, you know, increasing the, right, the hemorrhage. And what we can say is, again, you know, that women's trial, you know, they use a TXA and the outcome was there's a death or hysterectomy. Mm-hmm. But for the patient that, you know, in United States, actually most of the patients, you know, they get hysterectomy. And also, you know, it's different a little about, you know, in compared to Europe. But if the, you know, the question is, you know, can you decrease the amount of the hemorrhage or can you decrease the hysterectomy, which hysterectomy is out of the picture here? Does it make sense?
Yeah, I'm with you. Yeah, there's a lot to consider for those patients because obviously you're expecting far greater degrees of blood loss and morbidity as a consequence than you might do for a patient who is at much lower risk but doesn't have or is suspected of having abnormal placentation. The other thing that I don't think we have really any data on, or at least that I've seen, is the this conversation all focused about TXA. I had a feeling this was going to happen. Is that what do we know about whether patients that have suspected accreta, if they experience bleeding, what I really want to know is what is the incidence of excessive clot lysis in those patients? What do we know about that? If there is excessive clot lysis or hyperfibrinolysis, what is the degree of hyperfibrinolysis that we see? And what contribution do we think that has towards the amount of blood loss? Without that information, I think it's very hard, it's a hard sell either way to say, well, we should give this prophylactically for all PAS patients. Now, the comeback to that often is, well, we know that the safety data that we have on TXA is great. We don't see any evidence from what we know so far that these patients that receive it are at increased risk of arterial or venous thrombotic events versus those that don't. And I feel that's often used as an argument for justification, as well as the fact that, I don't know about in all countries, but in some countries that the cost of TXA is relatively low. So I feel like it's a hard sell for me to justify giving a drug based upon the fact that it's cheap and that it's not associated with an increased risk of thrombotic events versus placebo, when we don't actually know, certainly for specific populations like accreta patients, whether it actually results in a clinically meaningful improvement in maternal or perinatal outcomes. I feel like obviously we should get more information on that, but I don't know if we really have much or any at all to say everyone that has an accreta before their cesarean or cesarean hysterectomy should be getting tranexamic acid.
Alex, I would like to share my experience in Egypt or the country with the limited resources, if you allow me.
Sure, that'll be great.
Yeah. So when we were implementing Robson classification for cesarean section in different hospitals of Egypt, because Egypt is, Ashley has got the second highest cesarean section rate in the world after Brazil. Mm. And so according to the 2014 demographic health survey, it was 52%, and it's much higher than that when we conducted the Robson classification study in different hospitals. It was about 60%. But anyways, that was the one thing. So when we were visiting different hospitals, and because of the very high cesarean section rate, there's a high rate of placenta, and they have a high number of you know, children in the family. So then average is probably 4 or 5, and therefore there's an increasing incidence of placenta accreta and procretas. And they don't have national guidelines as such. And it's like each hospital have their own guidelines and it's like personal choices. But for their management of placenta accreta and procreta, the prophylactic treatment of tranexamic acid was there, and they religiously follow it as soon as the baby is delivered. And they have seen very promising results. And so I'm not sure that they have published any data on that, which I have encouraged when I was having discussion with them. But it was quite interesting to know that the way they were describing its effect, and they were following it religiously, it seems that for their setting, it was the treatment of choice as a prophylactic treatment for PPH. This was just something I wanted to share. Yeah.
So that's fascinating. I've got a question for you. Can you give us an idea about when these patients deliver in a, I know there's probably some variation, but in a whatever you want to consider a typical or an average hospital in Egypt, can you give us some sense about, you know, what's available or what isn't available? Give us an idea about what blood products are available, what the inventory is in terms of blood bank in these hospitals, what the level of the experience of the anesthesiologist and the surgical team are, to help us give us some context that may help us understand why you guys are using it probably more often than we are.
I mean, to be honest, I think they certainly have, you know, this tranexamic acid and misoprostol and SINT infusions and syntocinone, and very competent surgeons, and you know, proceeding to sort of hysterectomies and skillful hysterectomies and saving maternal lives and stuff. They have blood products, all kind of blood products. Blood banks are very efficient. They certainly don't have intervention, you know, radiologist facilities available. This is something that they really need to, you know, maybe they need to improve on. And the multidisciplinary approach is also missing in quite a lot of other hospitals, which we are stressing on to them when managing PPH. So yes, the multidisciplinary approach and interventional radiologists, these are the two sort of things that are missing in the management of PPH. But otherwise, they are using every single thing that we normally use in UK or US.
So Frank, if you're still on, I'd love to get your insight about if you have this drug available, and if you do, how you're using it and for whom you're using it on.
To be honest, I mean, I'm not actually looking into this in particular. I'm working more towards the Robson classification implementation for cesarean section. But this was like when we were discussing with the doctors, then it just comes up as a part of all discussion. And because I worked in UK in John Ratcliffe Hospital, Oxford, where we used to have this multidisciplinary approach with interventional radiologist and gynae oncologist while managing placenta, you know, percreta and creta. So, that's something that I can, you know, differentiate between the two settings.
Frank, I don't know if you can hear me, but Dr. Gitonga, if you're able to chat, I'd love to hear from you about how you use it, or if anyone else is online or on a call who can chat, give us your opinions about for whom you're using it on and how you're using it, whether it's prophylactic or therapeutically.
I can add on the experience from Egypt if you want to.
That would be great.
Yeah, I practiced like 2 years and have an anesthesia in Egypt for coming to the US. And yes, we used the tranexamic acid like in a regular basis, especially when we anticipated like bleeding. And we use it directly after the delivery. And we actually, as doctor said, we didn't have like instructions of this. It was somehow of a personal choice for most of the anesthesia providers back in Egypt. But it was like everywhere. I worked like in 2 university hospitals and 1 big military one. And it was all the same. When we anticipate like an accreta, brecreta, whatever, what we're going to do, especially we had like the availability of blood products, plasma fresh frozen, and the cryoprecipitate and everything. But this was the mainstay that we add as a different, actually, in some consultants, some prefer like up to 3 or 4 grams of Caprin to be introduced directly after the delivery of the baby on a slow rate. But we don't have papers, as doctor said, just it's mostly a personal preference by the doctors there.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. Okay, Kristen, I want to bring you in. Did you in the PAS community, are patients aware of this drug? And if they are, are they asking questions for their OBs or anesthesiologists about whether they're going to be getting it or not? I'm just curious if this has come up in any of the conversations you've had with anyone out there.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely heard about TXA in the patient community, and we see the articles that get published that make it seem like a really incredible treatment. So I think some of our educated patients are interested in it and asking about it, but probably not sophisticated enough to be, you know, advocating for getting it prophylactically. But I'm intrigued by this conversation. I think that Accreta cases are very different than some Increta and Percreta cases, right? And I think just the unpredictable nature of even diagnosed cases can make it a tough call. But at the end of the day, I mean, it's unlikely in the US that, from my perception, please correct me if I'm wrong, that it's gonna enable a woman to avoid a hysterectomy who's a diagnosed accreta, right? So then I guess it would get into what the provider's judgment is on, you know, the morbidity expected without it.
Right, I think that's an excellent comment. Yeah, I think it's not gonna change the underlying pathology. It's more about the mitigation of the degree of bleeding rather than whether you're absolutely right, whether someone's more likely, whether someone has an accreta and if they're going to need a hysterectomy or not. Agreed. I'm just curious, in terms of, as we are talking about blood loss mitigation, for folks that are involved in the perioperative management of women with suspected accreta, what typically do you guys order in advance of surgery in terms of blood products to have in the room? Can you give us an idea based upon where you are of what blood products you would order in terms of number and types? I'm curious to hear what people are doing and what, if there's any variation out there.
Alex, I gotta go to the OR. I jump in. We have a fairly active, morbidly adherent placenta program here at UCSF. We do, we get a great deal of referrals in from Northern California, and have a very well outlined protocol process for this. And right now, we just have generally for all of our accretas that we'll be doing in the IR suite, we have 4 cells and 4 plasma type and ready in the room and labeled. And to go back to the accreta issue, I'm always a little bit concerned about giving some of these agents prophylactically before the big bleed for, you know, lack of knowledge around the pharmacokinetics of some of these agents and what value they're going to actually add to a large surgical bleed that is likely to happen in the subsequent minutes.
Yeah. So, all right. What's everyone else doing?
Alex, at Baylor, you know, in our accreta program, we type and cross for 4 units and 2 FFB. So we have it in the OR, and usually we use it for just B cases. You know, if we are highly suspicious for accreta, you know, it means more increta per accreta. Usually if there's a focal accreta, no, she's type and cross for 4 units, but we don't have it in the OR. That's mm-hmm. what we do.
Right. Now I'm gonna basically like remind folks that are listening in that Ron and Amir and I are all based at tertiary care centers where we have highly experienced teams of anesthesiologists, obstetricians and gynecological oncologists that are experts at the management of women that have suspected or confirmed placental accreta. So in other places, obviously, I don't know what the experience levels are of some of these providers. And the reason why I bring this up is that on another call that I've been on in the past, and I'm not going to name any locations, but the lady who was on the call, who's an anesthesiologist, says that she's routinely giving somewhere between 20 to 30 units of red blood cells for each cesarean hysterectomy that she's involved with. Now, I cannot explain or provide you the reason as to why, but what that suggests to me is that places where we work, where we're providing hopefully great care, the quality of the perioperative care from an anesthetic and surgical standpoint is probably contributing to the fact that the amount of blood product that we are having to give is potentially lower than what it might be in other places where the need is higher, if the folks that are involved in the perioperative care may not have different skill sets and levels of experience compared to those that work in places like ours. Does anyone type and cross more than 4 units of red cells in advance of a suspected accreta case? All right, Anton, if you're still on, what do you do in Canada? What are you doing beforehand in terms of blood ordering?
Yeah, so it's interesting. I work at 2 separate centers. My main center, BC Women's Hospital, does not have an ICU. It does not have general surgery or gyne-onc surgery readily available. So we do not accept known morbidly adherent placenta patients to that center. Mm-hmm. Yep. So I don't have this problem at BC Women's. At another site where I work is a tertiary center with ICU, with all the general surgery, whatnot. And there, we do things that are very similar to you guys. Like we cross, we type and cross them 4 ahead of time. We don't do anything more because our blood bank is literally just next door. So we don't find that we have problems with significant delays when we ask for blood. So we don't really ask for anything more than 4.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So there's a couple of like things that you just talked about that like fired off buttons in my head, which is, it's not just about whether you have a blood bank that can support any request that you've got, but also the proximity of the blood bank and also what the mechanisms are for transporting blood products from blood bank to the OR when you need to keep up with evolving blood loss, be it for a PAS patient or someone on labor and delivery that's having, you know, going from, or the hemorrhage is evolving from mild to moderate to severe, right? So if you have a patient who is at high risk for major bleeding, who has suspected PAS, depending upon not just the location where you're delivering and the team, but also the inventory within blood bank and also the system for transferring or transporting blood products from there to you may influence what you're going to order in advance. So for example, if you know that the transportation process is not quite as quick as you would like, you may well choose to order more products ahead of time so that you can guarantee that the products are in the OR when you need them, rather than go lean, order say 2 or 4, if you're in a place where it's possible that the transportation process may not be as quick as you need it to keep up if there's problems with evolving blood loss that requires high volume and different types of blood products. So Thierry, we're going to wind this up soon, but I'm curious where you work. Where is blood bank to the OR and what's the transportation process that you have for blood products from blood bank to the OR when you need it? What do you guys have?
The blood bank is quite close. We have, I don't know if this is the correct expression, like pressurized tubes. So it's air pressure and we get the blood products within, let's say, 5 minutes. So we pre-order dependent on the pathology. We have a multidisciplinary discussion about every patient with morbidly adherent placenta. and we would order between 2 and 4 units to have in the room. And we are, since I guess 12 years or so, we work with fibrinogen mainly as a factor based, so we will not use FFP unless we need it for also for volume substitution.
Right.
We've also noticed that too. We've used a lot of fibrinogen in lieu of FFP recently. So
yeah, and we are doing also much the same. Pleased to hear that there's quite a few of us out there that are thinking the same way. Bismine, what is the sort of logistics in Egypt for keeping up if you need if there's an ongoing demand for blood products in the OR or on labor delivery? What typically would happen in Egypt or an Egyptian hospital? Hope she can hear me. Or Fatima, can you give us an idea where you are? What are the processes involved? I'm curious what it's like in places that aren't Stanford and UCSF.
Oh, so in my institution, actually, I was going to ask this question since we started the session, is that we do have the passive transfusion protocol whenever we have a postpartum hemorrhage patient. We just need to call the blood bank to activate the MTP, and then we get an emergency box issued. And the blood bank, because I work in a tertiary center, so the blood bank is within like 5 minutes, 10 minutes from the OR. And our hematologist colleagues are usually involved and are like, they're online with us. So what's been recently, it's like the couple last years, they've been pushing us to use fibrinogen concentrate as a first line, which was kind of a lot, that we had a lot of debate about it with them. And their rationale behind it, that they've been doing a cross-sectional study, and they found that most of our patients actually have low fibrinogen to start with. So this is why when we were talking about the transstomic acid and the woman trial that came up, that and we need to use this as soon as possible, their preference was fibrinogen concentrate. So I was curious to know what other, like, and maybe this is because I'm based in Kuwait, so maybe this is only, like, I haven't heard anything in SOAP or, you know, like in the UK, about any fibrinogen concentrate used as a first line. So this is why we are still going with the recent guidelines regarding, you know, give blood volume, and then give transmic as a, treatment. But I'm curious to know what the other thinks about this.
All right, well, how about this? We can go a little longer because that in itself is a topic which I'm sure could involve like a full hour of discussion. So we can keep going for an extra 10 minutes if folks are okay with that, just to try and get some opinions on that topic. You're absolutely right. I know certainly in terms of what's out there, there's a lot of interest in appropriate mechanisms or at least modalities for fibrinogen and supplementation. And I think a lot of folks will probably have seen studies that have shown at least that if you measure the fibrinogen level during the early phase of bleeding, and if the level is low, that's a strong prognostic indicator for patients progressing to severe PPH. And that when we think about low levels, we're not talking about levels of, depending on where you work, you know, less than 1 gram per liter or 100 milligrams per deciliter. We're talking here about levels that are less than 200 or maybe even potentially 250 milligrams per deciliter. So this is probably the basis for the questions that we're sort of discussing right now. So we know that there's this association there. Now it's a matter of deciding, okay, if we feel that the level is low, then do we need to supplement in advance or at the time when we recognize it? So we have fibrinogen concentrate available where we work, which is great. And there's several pluses, I think, to that, which are firstly, our massive transfusion protocol for obstetrics does not include cryoprecipitate. So if you wanted to treat a patient that has a low plasma fibrinogen level and you order cryoprecipitate, you're talking about quite a long period of time before you can get that product from the blood bank because it's not included in the MTP. So having an alternative available to you where the process involved in, you know, drawing it up and diluting and then giving is much quicker, at least in terms of turnaround time, than it would be than if you ordered cryoprecipitate, is a huge plus. We certainly know there's a good response when you give fibrinogen concentrate if you identify a patient that has a low fibrinogen level. And then the other thing just to bear in mind is obviously, like, even just the measurement time it takes to get a fibrinogen level or plasma concentration back from the lab can take a while, depending on where you work. That could be half an hour, 40 minutes, or even more than that. So is there a way to get some information back sooner about a fibrinogen level, or at least an alternative means of identifying that the fibrinogen contribution to clot formation is low? And the obvious answer to that question is, well, yes, there are point of care devices out there that can provide that information probably in a more timely fashion than when you would get back from the lab. And I think here we're talking about point of care devices, and the ones that most obviously come to mind are thromboelastometry, the TEG device, and rotational thromboelastometry, which is the Rotem device. So what we could do is talk a little more about fibrinogen concentrate if folks want to, and then we can table a discussion if you folks are interested about point of care devices for a follow-up call. How do people feel about that?
Alex, for point of care, that here we use Rotem, but usually, you know, the way that we use Rotem or TEG, you know, if the patient have MTP, you know, we usually don't run it, you know, because MTP, you give it the products until the patient is stable, and then after that we start using Rotem or TEG, you know, it depends on which hospital that I'm working. But I think, you know, I found it very useful, specifically, you know, sometimes the question, the argument is, okay, so we have to keep the fibrinogen, for example, about 250, but even if the fibrinogen is less than 250 and you get a firm clot, you know, based on your TEG or Rotem study, I think, you know, you can kind of argue against, you know, giving fibrinogen concentrate or cryo. I know that in trauma is a little different. Trauma, usually they run it at the same time the patient is actively bleeding. But my experience here is, you know, whenever the patient has MTP, is hemodynamic unstable, you give the products until the patient becomes stable. Anyone else has any idea?
Great question, Amir. I mean, there's times we've seen patients there where the bleeding has stopped, at least clinically, and you get the fibrinogen level back, and it could be less than 200 or 250, but the vitals look okay. There's clinically no evidence of active bleeding. And I think in that situation, what we would do is just hold off, but we'd obviously watch the patient super closely in case there's any further evidence of reactivation of the bleeding, and then give fairly early if that was the case. But in a patient with ongoing evidence of active bleeding, and you've got a fibrinogen level back that's low, we would have a very low recourse to start supplementing at that point. We wouldn't hold off. So I think it really depends upon what the clinical information is at the time when you get the level back. I think that's that's what you're saying, correct?
Yes. And yeah. Here we usually keep the fibrinogen above 300. It's anecdotally, again. Mm-hmm. There's no evidence. Yeah. The best evidence that we have, again, you know, it says above 2 grams, or based on the Rotem, you know, if you're 15, you know, it's adequate, I can say.
Right. And the other thing to bear in mind, whether you use the lab or whether you use point of care, the other great thing about these, the information you get back, is they're useful to ruling out. It's not just ruling in, ruling out a coagulopathy or a low fibrinogen level to avoid the possibility of patients getting other blood products like plasma or platelets or even cryo, where they may not otherwise need it if these values or levels are within an acceptable range. So for example, if you use a fixed ratio approach and you weren't assessing any of these lab values on a regular basis, then obviously the concern is you're exposing patients to blood products that they may not otherwise necessarily need if you use a fixed ratio approach as opposed to maybe a goal-directed approach? No, I know that's a that there's some strong opinions on that one, and I get that. But from what we're seeing, certainly in patients that have massive PPH, the incidence of a low fibrinogen level, be it if you want to use a threshold of say less than 2 or less than 200, it's not rare, but it's not high, even in those patients. So it's another advantage of using these devices that you can get that information back fairly quickly, and then you can decide if you need to give it or not, or at least you can assess what the quality of your resuscitation is like and whether it's been good or not based upon the trend data you get back from these devices. Thierry, what do you feel about that? I know you've got a lot of interest in this stuff.
Yeah, I fully agree with what you say. I would say in an unexpected PPH, our ROTEM is more likely to rule out the need of fibrinogen. In the case of the morbidly adherent placenta, we usually use it to guide our fibrinogen therapy. But most frequently, we rule it out.
Yeah. Yep. Well, guys, I have to say, this has been great. Really great. I can't believe it's already, it's 10 past 12 California time. I don't know what time it is in Europe or in Egypt, but I can't thank you guys enough for joining. This has been really, really good. And if there's still interest in doing this again, I'm happy to set it up. If folks can give me an idea if they'd like to sort of do another session and
please
ask different questions, then we can definitely do that. And I can try and set something up in the next few weeks if people want that. Does that sound good?
Yes, absolutely.
Sounds good, yeah.
Yeah, great.
Fantastic. Thanks, Alex.
Okay, great.
Great.
Thanks, thank
Alex.
You, Alex. Thanks.
Yeah. It was great. Thanks.
Yeah, no
thanks.
Problem.
Thanks, everyone.
All right, we'll keep an eye on Twitter, and I'll try and tee something up in the next few weeks. Thanks so much for joining.
Take care. Bye.
All right,
Alex, it would be
care.
Great if you can actually post it in your account so we can know exactly when, so we can join.
Yeah, do you want me to? I'll just post on my Twitter feed. Does that sound good?
Sounds good. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks, guys. You take care. I'll see you soon. Okay, bye. If anyone does, that's on the call, and what their feeling or their opinion. Riley, I don't think that they will be recommending that all women get TXA before vaginal or cesarean delivery. The other would include.